George Jetson. His boy Elroy. Daughter Judy. Jane, his wife.
Local slidewalk.
I still remember when you used to be 9 years old. Yeah, I was a fool for you. Now the bottom of my soul. Yeah, yeah, now that you're grown up, old enough to know. Yeah, yeah, you want to leave me. Yeah, you want to let me go. Yeah, yeah, I want you to know. I said, I want you to know right now. You've been good to my baby. Better than I've been to myself. And if you ever leave me, I don't want nobody else. I said, I want you to know. I said, I want you to know right now. You know you make me wanna. Come on now. Come on now. Come on now. Come on now, take it easy, 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 take it easy. It's a little bit softer now, 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 a little bit softer now.
All righty. Let's test my audio. Okay. Apologize for these audio snafus. And I hope my voice is coming in rather clearly. So hello, anybody that might be watching and that may be watching in the future. Much appreciated. So we're doing 1962 in space flight. let's put an end to that madness. 1960. Well, this film was from 1961, but the song was a hit in 1962. Of course, the original was by Otis Day and the Knights. Good to see you, Mr. Guido, Brother Guido. So 1962, pretty wild year. Let's see if I can get some background music going for myself. It's not too loud. There we go. Alrighty. So yeah, the Jetsons came out in 1962 in full color. The first time apparently on whatever channel that was, CBS or something, that color was displayed proudly. That makes me wonder when the Flintstones came out, because I'm guessing the Flintstones came out before that. Thought they did anyway. 1962, there was also the Cuban Missile Crisis happened in October. But we're going to start... I'm going to start in February, when we have our launch of John Glenn. So if we recall, in 1961, when we had the first human being launched into orbit, which was a Russian named Yuri Gagarin, and also in 1961, the first American did get to space, Alan Shepard, but he did not actually go into orbit. And Alan Shepard was launched on a Mercury Redstone. And that's only designed to do a ballistic orbit, which is just up and down. So they go high enough to get into space, and then they launch back down. People may recall William Shatner just did that pretty much same flight a couple months ago. The William Shatner. Pretty much that's what they're doing for fun now. That's what Alan Shepard did, and a couple other ones in the Mercury Redstone rocket, which, as you can see, is very much based off of the V2 still. Remember, this is the Wernher von Braun's stuff. But the one that's designed for actual Earth orbit, in order to be a little, needs to be a little stronger. And that one is the Atlas. And the Atlas, the early version of the Atlas, because today they're still using the Atlas V. The early Atlas obviously was a ICBM. So if we recall, these space rockets were basically ICBMs that were commandeered or given to the civilian NASA industry in order to do these programs. Supposedly, I mean, there's obviously the conspiracy theories of, you know, them being used for clandestine weapons operations and stuff like that. Which, sure, why not? So we had the Atlas rocket, which, what am I looking for here? Oh, yeah. So the Mercury Atlas. So again, the Mercury program was the initial program of putting a single man into orbit by the Americans. Because remember, the Russians were doing their Vostok program, where they were straight up just launching into orbit. And they had already done it a couple times at this point. Where about America's taking it slow in the space race. And they are, and they're just trying to do it safely. And they've already launched men into ballistic orbit into space, but not into actual orbit. John Glenn is going to be the first one. Now, I've done tests on this rocket here. I've done a little bit of changes from our previous rendition of the Atlas. Not much, I mean, because this thing is a pain. I can't wait till we lose this stage and a half on the Atlas. The reason why they did this, because this part, this little chamber where these two side rockets, these two side engines fall off once we get up into lower pressure atmosphere, and then it's only this one middle engine that's doing all the pushing. That way, you know, we get a lower release of fuel, and it sort of regulates the speed, because at this point they sort of had the capability, but with this design of rockets, didn't have the capability of turning on and off. So if I end up doing that, it's cheating. Even though I can do that in this game. Turning the rocket on and off. So rather than throttling it back and forth, they just dropped off two of the engines. So this entire thing is designed to get this one space capsule into orbit. This is a single stage to orbit. So I don't think I should have to do any. I mean, I've tested this thing enough. It gets barely into orbit. Somehow I tried it over and over again, and I was like, you know what? I'm not going to let this trip me up. I know I can get it into orbit and get out of orbit. It's not designed to go into a nice orbit just to get this Kerbal into orbit. We want John. We don't want Al. Al already went. So I think we're ready. I think we are ready to do it. So, and John Glenn went and orbited the Earth three times. He's visited by Kennedy. There's all kind of videos of him and Kennedy looking in the spacecraft and stuff. Whoops. All right, we're going to launch this guy. So, 1962. Target started in 1962. Taco Bell started in 1962. Kmart and Walmart started in 1962. To give an idea of, and a taco cost 19 cents, by the way. This is also the year that Navy SEAL started. Oh man, is this Ray Charles? This is really. What is this? This proper space music? I don't know. We're gonna do it. Like I'm planning on monetizing this. All right. So we're going to turn on our stability assist system since, I mean, this thing had computers, as primitive as it was. I mean, it had very basic. Well, actually, you know what? I might even be wrong about that as far as what we're understanding as computers. It had to have had something. I'm really not familiar with the Mercury capsule systems. I mean, it had to have some way to guide. I know that the astronauts in this were actually able to guide themselves. Like they could take over the entire reins of the capsule. I mean, it couldn't do much except for kind of poof around. Now the Russian, the original Russian Vostok, that guy in there couldn't really do anything. That's completely in control from ground control. So that's what was one major difference between the American and the other ones. And it's still super loud, but now almost is. Come on, just go. Whoopsie. Alrighty. Also, fun fact, Johnny Carson was, he started in 1962, taking over for, Alan Parr? I don't remember who he took over for. I wasn't there. All right, so get kind of nervous now. Do the Twist, I heard that's what this song is. And I must have heard the first split second of that note and knew what it was and said that because I did not know that was Do the Twist was coming on. All right, so we're launching. Nice slow launch. So the trajectory I need to go in for this, because this is a single, there's no staging. I have one chance to do this. I have to get up high enough and get enough vertical or horizontal speed rather, which I'm not even going to go horizontal until I'm way up in the atmosphere. I haven't practiced this recently, so. I think if I have the urge to, before I end this, and I do this successfully, I'll probably, I want to do one from completely inside the capsule like this, just using the ball. I might do that towards the ending of it, like from the Kerbal's point of view. I also kind of want to demonstrate this top escape rocket, because this escape rocket is meant to detach this crew hatch from this whole thing if it starts to go bad. Yeah, so you guys sitting up in this thing, going up, straight up. I think when I get up to about 500 meters per second, I'm going to tilt over a lot more and actually probably drop off the, because at this point I'm up in low enough atmosphere that, there we go, I don't need all that weight. And now I really got to turn over and get rid of that thing. Won't work anymore at this point. We're inevitably heading into space. Right now our apoapsis is 50 miles. In this game, remember, miles is this game is not to scale with real life. So that means even though right now we are currently 40 miles up, we are inevitably going to be 56 miles up even if the engine stopped. Since the engine is still going, our apoapsis is rising. The and our periapsis should also be adjusting as our speed should be increasing in order to actually get us into an orbit. So right now we're 1,000. We got to get up to, we got to get close to 3,000. We've really got to get our speed up. This apoapsis needs to go down, needs to get to at least 70. Be close. And close. I kind of didn't adjust the amount of fuel. Oh, yeah. We'll see if this works. On John Kerbin. Speed is still increasing. There's where we left off from. As you can see, we went really steeply up and then hit it over. And we're still making our way. So now we're trying to get this latitude or horizontal. Our periapsis is, I mean, our apoapsis is up past 76, 70, 80. So we're, our arc is good. We really gotta, I think we're good. I'm slow and, all right, so well, I'm gonna, let's see. Just trim up our orbit. I am gonna cheat a little bit. Let's get rid of that stuff. All right, so we're going around in this orbit here. When I get up to 183, matter of fact, let's, actually, no. Let's just warp there. And what I need to do is straighten out my orbit a bit. My periapsis is still below the atmosphere at my lowest point. So when I swing back around the Earth, because now I'm essentially in orbit, for all intents and purposes, except for my orbit, one side of my orbit is too low, so it dips down into the atmosphere, which is going to basically, I mean, in real life, all orbits are like that. It's just the higher that you go, the less that that happens. We can stop that warp now. I really just need to make sure my periapsis is 56, 57. Got to get it up past 70. All right, you know what? I feel like I'm cheating too much by restarting this rocket. So I'm going to detach. Boom. And there's our guy. John Kerbin up in space. Get rid of our stability and do a little bit of whirl in there. We're going to turn on our, these are our RCS thrusters. Okay. Now we're a little bit about out of control. Turn on our stability assist. Go. Yeah, I am kind of curious now if the original Mercury capsule didn't have technically like how it actually like I imagine it had gyroscopes in order so that something could tell so there was it gave some kind of reading through a gyroscope of what direction it was facing based on its gyroscope. A gyroscope being like this machine that has this perfect spinning thing in it so that it's when something is spinning, it's essentially under its own centrifugal force. So that no matter which something is moving around it, it's still going to be moving at the same force because of its spin. So it essentially can read what direction whatever it's in is facing. That's a pretty ingenious thing, I think. I need to make my orbit a little bit better. So we launched from about, if we look at the planet, here's this island. We launched from about over here. We came up here, and our orbit went so fast that it went around. Right now, our highest point is our apoapsis, which is right here. I'm actually going to warp to that right now. Because I need to adjust my periapsis, which is the lowest point of my orbit. Because not all orbits are perfect circles. Oops. Base where I'm going. Hold on here. That's behind me. Yeah, I'm around the back side of the planet now. So now I'm going to use my RCS thrusters just to boost my orbit a little bit. Just to get me up. Now, like, the game has, like, a hard cutoff point for the atmosphere to where you can just stay in orbit, which is not realistic. Because it's just a matter of how long it takes for you to drag back down into orbit, depending on how many particles. It's sort of just the spectrum of it. Can I turn on the light? Yeah. So, yeah, we get outside the view of here. Let me turn off the... Well. All right, so John Glenn went around about three times. Now the retro rockets on this thing are horribly primitive. When I finally read about this to make something like it in this, which is these solid rockets, which just bunch of solid rocket boosters are just. It's like some kind of like gel powder type of thing, and once you light it, it just you can't unlight it. Versus like with the liquid fuel rockets, it's sort of a mixture usually, and in order to stop it from burning, you just stop the mixture from happening, like mechanically. That way, you can. That's one of the theories behind the liquid rockets. Well, one of the mechanics behind liquid rockets, anyway. And. Oops. And Guido, let me know if the music is like too loud for my voice or anything. If you please, that ends up happening. So yeah, and so at the same time while this was going on, this Mercury program, they were working on the Saturn rocket already, a very early version of it. And they were also working on the Gemini program already, which the Gemini program, or they call it Gemini, is similar to this Mercury program, only the craft has a... The craft is a... Whoops. That was a little too fast. it holds two people. Yeah, get over. Whoops. So the Gemini, yeah, that's, and I guess that's why it's called Gemini, because it's two people. So that's, and this is basically the earliest, I mean, so there's those three iterations. The Mercury program, which is this, Gemini program, which is the two astronauts up there. And that's when they were, like, working on Rendezvous, and also, working on docking and detaching and stuff like that. And also in the Gemini programs where they were doing EVAs, extravehicular activity. But this one is just the guy up there doing his thing, testing all the technologies before they landed. So what we got to do to get this guy back down, so we can't have him trapped up there. So that's where we have these retro rockets. And because we're going in this direction, it's pretty simple. All we got to do is face the other direction and then burn the rocket. But there's a matter of when you do that. Because if we're trying to save fuel, which those little tiny rockets only have enough fuel to burn for like not a long time, maybe a couple seconds. So if I, and my orbit is lopsided, it's kind of elliptical. So elliptical orbit, I mean, there's orbits where they're just like when you get to the moon, you're from parking orbit, you're basically making your Earth orbit just get bulgier until it overlaps with the moon. But even at these small differences, so right now my periapsis, so my lowest point of my orbit is about 70 miles. My highest point is about 200 miles. So what that means is if I burn my rocket, my retro rocket, for instance, at my periapsis, it's going to, if I'm trying to get back down into Earth, if I burned over in this, over where my periapsis is, where I have a lower altitude, it's going to take more rocket energy to lessen my altitude over here. Because remember, when you're burning your rocket fuel, it's affecting your orbit on the other side of the sphere. Because you're not going to see any difference no matter how hard you burn your rocket when you're over here. You're only going to see it when you're ending up on the other side of your orbit. So we're going to want to make sure that we are at our apoaps, do our retro burn, which is going to decrease our already low periaps of 70 miles, and it's going to dip it down so that we can get back down. And we should do that soon, because I do want this to land in the water. Right now, if I dip it, it looks like that's what it's going to do. So let's do that. So yeah, so we're going to get this guy back home. John Kerman, you did good. So what we need to do, yeah, there's our space image. So John Kerman, we're going to warp up to our apoaps. Boom. Come on. And all right. Now we're going to tell him to face retrograde, which is backwards. All right. And we're going to, now what's going to happen when I boost these rockets, our orbit over here is going to, it's going to be gone. Mathematically, this is the way this stuff works. It's just going to, you're going to decrease here. It's going to pull it down over here. So let's make sure our staging is right. Because one time I did this practicing and pretty much destroyed the... Wait, what's going on here? What's going on? It won't let me change something or other. All right, we need to activate that now. Oh no, we got to activate all of them. That's not good. That could have went better. So for some reason it wasn't letting me add another stage, because I was going to pull these three rockets. All right, well, at least it worked. So, yeah. So that drastically decreased our orbit, and now we're no longer in a circle around the sphere. We're just in another ballistic arc, because we just went around the other direction and burned those rockets. I don't know what happened there. I'm supposed to be able to hit this plus sign, and it's supposed to give me an extra layer, an extra staging thing. And that way I could activate only those three rockets at the same time. But for some reason, I couldn't do that. But then it wouldn't let me activate the rockets. Oh, man, that was close. It went out of control. But we got it. It's cool. So now we are basically falling. So let's go around to... Alright. Actually, we have to get rid of this stuff. Let's decouple that. Alright, well, there it went. That was our rocket stage we just flushed out. So we don't need that anymore. All we need is make sure our parachutes are going to work. Oh, I do need to adjust that, actually. Was it the wrong pressure and they blew up one of our test flights? So we're going to make the come out at 900 miles up. Or 900 miles. Not miles. He's mighty handy. With a gun. It's kind of like kilometers, but actually, I better increase that. Make it about 12. It's about a kilometer up is what that's supposed to be. Well, this game makes that about a mile up. Alrighty. Our Kerbal down here is pretty looking pretty happy. All right, let's fast forward this bit. All right, we are now entering the atmosphere. I thought he was going to land during the daytime. Landing right as the sun's going down. Actually, that's the sun coming up, so we're landing right in the morning side. There we go. See the heat shield heating up. We got some, we got some plasma happening, and again, that's from basically the particles, the electrons and stuff not being fast enough to get out of the way of how fast this thing is actually coming in. So it's basically squishing the electrons out of them. Yeah. I think it's the electrons that's being squished out of them. I could be wrong about that. I think I was wrong about that before. Whatever it is, it's plasma. I believe is either... Well, if it was electrons, so this would be ionized plasma. So, and I think that is what's happening. You know, it's amazing. You don't study this stuff and you forget it. Then again, I can't remember the last time I thought about ionized plasma, except for in context of this stuff. But in either case, this is slowing down by a lot. It just went from like thousands of meters a second to a couple hundred meters a second. The G forces, that sort of thing. It's oh man. I wanted it to be daytime. Alright, let's just fast forward. Coming down into the clouds. Kind of cool. It always makes me think of I Dream a Genie. What happened? Did I not? Oh, that's so terrible. I didn't I did not activate the parachutes. Oh my goodness. That's terrible. I didn't activate the parachutes. I was like, wait a minute. I wasn't even paying attention to the... Should I just go back to the Space Center, or should I revert that entire flight? You know what? I can't lose John Kerman. I'm going to revert. That was a test flight. Okay, that was a flight simulation. Because John Kerman, he's perfectly fine. John Kerman, great flight, John Kerman. there's a few other flights. They did a couple other of these anyway. Oh, that's so terrible. That's like the worst thing that could happen. That test flight going bad. I mean, with that monk, that Kerman Simeon in there. There were a couple more of those flights. Scott Carpenter and Wally Schirra within this year. Are the ones who... All right, so moving on. Other than that, I'm going to do another one of those. I'm also going to demonstrate this this thing coming up. But anyway. There's this wonderful page that I've been using that... So in 1962, 96 spacecrafts were launched. So just to compare, in like 1961, 60 spacecrafts. In 1960, 44 spacecrafts were launched. In 1959, 24. In 1958, 28. Now these are just launch attempts. They're not necessarily launches that made it anywhere. 1957, 3. Those are like tests for Sputniks. So, just to give you an idea of the exponential growth of space technology. One, 1960, 44. 1961, 60. 1962, 96. Next year, 1963, also 96. That's interesting. I'm not sure there's some Illuminati code for that. there were... sorry about messing around with the mic. There were tests. Flights to Venus. Venus flybys that America did. And also Russia. The Soviets did Venus flybys. Americans used the Mariner craft. The Mariner craft... something that I have also just designed here. The Russians also did their flyby. Now, the Russians also launched something to Mars this year, by the way, called Mars and Mars 1, I believe. And they lost, one of them didn't even make it out of Earth orbit, and the other one they lost contact with before it got anywhere near Mars, as far as they know. Or maybe it got near Mars, but they have no way of knowing because the spacecraft failed in any case. And who knows? There's still some interplanetary stuff happening. As I said, the Mariner craft and the was what Americans used to send to a Venus flyby. And I think I might do that. However, Americans were also doing a program called the Ranger program. Because remember, John Kennedy said, we're going to the moon. So the Ranger program, because America had not yet touched the moon, and in previous years the Soviets have actually impacted stuff into the moon at this point. So now America is like, we got to. So that's, see all these Ranger programs. I think there's another Ranger 3 this year, because earlier years they were trying it too, and they end up just missing the moon or sending stuff flying by the moon. The Ranger probes were designed, and I actually had to redesign my Ranger probes. So I call them minor, what am I called? Poachers for the Rangers. It's a poacher 4. There we go. So the Ranger probes were sent up. I redesigned this. I had one nice and designed. And you know what? I didn't even test this design because it didn't work anyway. But I designed it the way they were trying to do. So the Ranger probes had these solar panels that pulled down. And they impacted this thing into the moon. And it also had this detachable thing. This detachable piece of the spacecraft that had like a seismometer in it, and I assume some sort of radio equipment, and it detached and it had its own rocket. And before it hit the moon, this detached, and it was supposed to like be a lander, although I don't see how they really expected that to work, unless they just intended it to only slow it down enough, and they called it a lander, like tongue-in-cheek, because this thing isn't landing anything. But so yeah, I haven't actually tested how this thing is going to work after it detaches. I put some batteries in it, some extra batteries. I did put seismometer sensors in it, but there's no way it's going to be of use, although I did put a radio in it just in case. But yeah, this is meant to crash into the moon. And this is meant to detach before it crashes into the moon and give out signals. Oh, and also has camera on it to take pictures. Kind of like what we just did recently with the asteroid. What's the asteroid called? Didymos, and its little tiny asteroid moon. We just crashed a satellite with a camera into that. And there was also cameras all watching it from telescopes from Earth. So there's pretty cool pictures of that. I might actually bring that up and show it. It's so cool that we just did that. I'm not sure if you know what, yeah, just a kind of side note, what's it called, art. Yeah, so we just did this. So this is from a telescope at Earth. We just crashed. As you can see, this is the explosion from us crashing into this tiny moon, into an asteroid's moon. That's terrible pictures. There were also tiny, what's called CubeSats, following along, watching from a distance. This is what it looked like when it crashed in. So there was a tiny asteroid orbiting this other asteroid, and when it finally hit it and exploded, that's video capture of it happening. And they also had a camera on the thing when it landed, or when it crash landed, which we'll do a muted Scott Manley, because he's just gonna have the picture what that looked like. So this is the asteroid, and all this asteroid is actually, so this is a smaller asteroid that's orbiting a larger asteroid, like its own moon, and we crashed this thing into it. It's basically a rubbish pile, so it's really just a pile of rocks. It's not like a solid rock, like, you know, you have these ideas of asteroids being solid rocks, kind of like the moon seems to be, but this is and this thing we sent when it hit, it was traveling 4 miles a second. So every 4 miles, that's when it finally hit. And this video taken from a telescope on Earth. Oops, you're not even. And that entire thing is like that entire thing that's moving is both the small asteroid and the big one, like, because the telescope from Earth can't make out the difference between the two. Their light just blends together. So, but we do see the explosion and the explosion explosive, like, vaporization of the spacecraft and all of the, so what they think that they're doing, which I'm skeptical, is that they're actually going to be able to do it, but they redirect an asteroid if an asteroid is ever hitting anybody, hitting anybody, is ever going to hit the entire Earth, rather. All it is experiments about how much they can change the trajectory of an asteroid by hitting stuff into it. So yeah, there's a whole bunch of random cameras, or not random, but random telescopes. Not random, but, you know, other telescopes caught this from all over the world. Here's one from a telescope in Kenya, capturing it. Telescope in Ethiopia. I don't know where that is. Nyots Mador. I don't know where that is. But yeah, that's them capturing it. I mean, that's some epic Star Wars stuff right there. Pre-impact, post-impact. From some other random near cam. Yeah, and then we got those pictures. From the CubeSat. I wish there were videos from the CubeSat. I mean, I thought that there were going to be. Yeah. But anyway. Hey, Praise I Am. Good to see you, brother. Fancy seeing you here, brother. So yeah, we had our first orbit of a human American. Now we're gonna do our Ranger 4, although it's gonna be called Poacher 4. And the rocket this is using is an Atlas, which is the same thing we just saw to use to get John Glenn up into orbit. Only instead of this other rocket, we had the Mercury capsule on top of this guy. Now instead, we have what's called the Centaur rocket on top of the Atlas rocket. That's why this is called the Atlas Centaur array. And so what this is going to do is, first we're going to get it into a parking orbit, similar to what John Glenn just did on his very successful orbit and return to Earth. Our staging good, I think it is. Our fuel, I think I just packed this thing full of fuel. Top one doesn't have a lot of fuel. I was redoing this over and over again because I was trying to get just the right mixture of fuel and weight for it to get into the proper orbit, but I think we're good enough. Let's launch it. So the Centaur rocket that's on top of this guy was special because it was designed to, in order, it was designed to be turned off and turned back on again. Oh, look at that thing wobbling. That's kind of I'm going to turn on auto struts, which is sort of lets you do that even outside of the bay, which I don't care. That's kind of cheating. Not really. That way it stops wobbling around like that. Alrighty, so our Atlas Centaur. Now the Centaur is that rocket. The top, some iteration of that is still in use. You have a question? You know what? I forgot. I was going to do this. I'm going to, if somebody wants to actually join in and ask me any question, I'm going to put a link. But, yeah, go ahead and ask your question, Mr. Cukes. I'm gonna have so many like copyright things on the for this video. Yeah, you can ask your. I mean, if you don't have to join in, I'm gonna ask your question. But actually, I was gonna put a. How do I do that? I forgot now. I just hit invite and it gives me a link. And I just pin it, I suppose. Actually. No. Actually, I can put it as a comment and then pin it. Haha, brilliant. It's on StreamYard and not. Oops. How do I pin it? I don't feel like messing around with that, but what engine am I using on the Agena? This is because I don't have. I'm in career mode, so it's going to be one of the early ones. Let me see. Let me find out real quick. Now, if you mean what engine, like in real life, the analog to the Agena, I don't know. I mean, I'm not trying to get too crazy accurate. Otherwise, I would use the real, like download the actual real rockets. So I am using the swivel, it looks like. I think I'm using the swivel just because of the size and probably its thrust. Because I'm not sure if it's accurate that the Agena the Agena rocket bill had a gimbal on it, rather than using its own like vernier thrusters in order to control its trajectory, but yeah, this is the swivel there's only two engines that are this size that I can use, because the game doesn't give you a lot of options. If you're using stock parts, so it's either the swivel or the other one that isn't as. I think the other that might be wrong. The other one, but not the case. I guess I'm not trying to get too crazy detailed. Just enough to make it look right a little bit, in its own silly Kerbal way. Oh wait, did you say Agena? Did I say Centaur? Yeah. You know what? You might have just corrected me, which is awesome. Because I know I just said Centaur. And the Ranger and Atlas Agena. Yes. Yes, sir. So for the Ranger 4, which... I didn't realize it until the last minute, and I had to go and redesign it. But the Ranger 4 probe was a Block 2 Ranger probe, which was the same design was used in the Mariner probes, with the way that the solar panels came down and its basic bus that it used, the hexagonal core and that sort of thing. But it actually has a detachable. I think I am using a Terrier. I think if that's the tiny one, I am using that in this smaller in this piece of this spacecraft, the smaller spacecraft that's going to detach. But no, that's the swivel, and the bottom one that I'm using for the Atlas is the skiff. Those three are the same. Although I have, did I crank them all up? The middle one's only 80 thrust. I did. I'm adjusting the thrust for now. When I just used this Atlas in my my Mercury flights, I adjusted the thrust limit down to I think 90 for the two side boosters, and I think I'm not sure. I think like 89 or something for the middle one. Just so, because otherwise the orbit was way too elliptical. But let me get this up in a nice. Equatorial parking orbit. It's going to get loud. And I think I'm going to do the same type of thing where I'm going to let it get up super high altitude before I tip it over. I can't believe it. So, yeah, Centaurs replaced. Yeah, we're not using Aeginas anymore. We're using Centaurs now for the second stage. But that's what that is true about the Aegina, though, that they were used to reignite while they were in space. At that point, they figured out that that was possible. Although, when they had designed the original Atlas rocket, they did not know that that was possible, which is why they had these pieces of the engines dropping off. Let's see how high we're getting. We're already there. We're kind of losing our inclination there a bit. Not being as careful as I was with, well, that's funny because at least remember like getting in the orbit as I was with the Mercury program, since I have this bit of extra fuel to play with. Although, I mean, technically, yeah, the Atlas should be fine to get me in total orbit. This is the secondary one is used for the lunar injection. Let's see, we're still what is it not? I forgot all about to detach that. Means I was going way too fast, way faster than I wanted to be going. I'm gonna have to tip this over a lot in order to get into any kind of proper orbit now. That sucks. In forgetting to detach those two side rockets, it made my speed super fast, which has made my main Apoapsis orbit, where I meant it to be like 70 miles up, it's now about 100 miles up, which isn't too bad. But I need to tip it down because we look over at our planet's orbit, our orbit of the sphere that we're in. There's the arc that we're going up in. And you can see that that's... Now, because I'm still trying to stick with some realism, I don't want to turn this off, wait until I get up to my Apoapsis. All right, so we're out of fuel on that one. All right, so that's out of fuel. Now this has got to detach. Make sure it's the right one. There we go. All right, we're not really in a too good of an orbit, but again, we have a whole other rocket here. This thing did originally get into a parking orbit. You know what? I am going to wait until we get onto our Apoapsis. I'm just going to warp straight up to there. I don't need the shroud anymore. We're still in warp. Let's get out of warp first. That shroud's gone. Let's make sure we don't crash back down into the planet. you still will have enough fuel to get into translunar injection. There we go. Now our orbit is in a nice 100 some miles by 100 some miles. So what we just did was, now our periaps, here's our apoaps. We just made that a little rounder around the planet and so that part of it wasn't too low dipping into the atmosphere. There's our spacecraft. Made as real as I could. I mean, as far as the parts that I could use. So now that we're in parking orbit, we can kind of hang out here and check out the best time and place. Now, in real life, they did a lot of math. I'm going to add a maneuver, and I'm just going to say, all right, if we burn this rocket for, let's see, 15 seconds, it's going to do that. It's going to make this, again, if we're in orbit and we're here, we burn the rocket facing that direction, it's going to make our orbit turn into this. In other words, our apoaps is going to get really high up. It's like our main altitude, which is going to just, okay. So we need to burn enough for it to get far enough to get close to the moon. But the moon, it's got to be in the right place. So if I move around where, around this orbit, we do our maneuver. There we go. We can see when we're going to get near the moon for when it's moving around, such as right here. So we just need to do this well enough to where this is going to intercept the moon properly. Using not too much fuel. Let's see. That looks like it's going to pretty much hit the moon. If not, that's close. Let's see. Oh, that was hitting it. Yeah, the periaps is totally gone. Oh, that's, we gotta do that right now. Second burn. Straight towards the moon there. Pretty much. Although, again, this is affecting our orbit on the other side of the planet. It's just that it's going to cause them to intercept. All right, let's see what we got. Now our orbit is no longer a circle. We burned enough to where it broke the circle. It's hitting the moon here. All right, we need to do some orbital adjustments. Mid-course corrections, rather. Now, it would be nice if I had the mod where I could just click in and say, hey, get me into an orbit that's within 2 meters of the surface. but I don't have that. So I'm going to need to adjust this a little bit and just kind of take a look and see. I don't have a lot to change. There we go. Looks like it's going right. Let's see. No. Close. 167. I'm trying to get it right into the moon. Come on, come on. So close. I mean, I won't need to adjust it. Well, all right, I know I can do this. Let's try one more round of, because I kind of end up just waiting and doing it with the smaller thrusters, which is probably what I'll end up doing. But I should be fine doing it like this. Let's see, 192. 199, rather. Yeah, this is definitely hitting the moon. There's no way it's not hitting the moon. I don't care what that moon periapsis says. Maybe that's the periapsis before it slams into the moon. All right, so I think we're good. We do have rockets. I do have thrusters on this thing. Matter of fact, I believe I just did that sort of wrong, because I think the course corrections I just did. Yeah, let me detach this guy. All right. Get our little solar panels going out there. So here comes, there's our Ranger probe. So this should still be heading into the moon. It's really close. I hope that's going to be close enough. And we'll find out. So I'm not going to... So this has some thrusters on it, but yeah, there's also a rocket inside of this bulge thing, which it's just supposed to detach and then land slightly, not land, but I guess soften its impact for this this probe to send back like different readings. Because the other one had a camera on it. But yeah, this one had a seismometer. So I'm not exactly sure what type of science they were getting from that. Because if it's a seismometer, I don't know if they meant for it to be reading something else that hit later. I'm not exactly sure. That was what I read. So I'm going to use the facilities. Oopsie. And I'll be right back.
Please don't hurt me. Please don't make me cry. I don't know what I'd do if you'd ever say goodbye. Remember, I love you so much, and love is life's greatest joy. Please don't break my heart like a child breaks a little toy. Sweetheart.
Alrighty. Alright, so we got Mr. Ranger Probe going to moon. Let's speed up this flight a little bit here. Whoops, keep flipping that off there. I guess I'm just going to go to the map here, and then we're going to warp to, let's see, I mean, this is going to get really close. Problem is, it's going to get close enough to hit it. I could try to just make a couple quartz corrections to see if I can get a little closer. Where I'm actually hitting the moon. Like that burn time is a lot. The idea is to do it with obviously using as little fuel as possible. And now that I've just detached our main rocket, we don't really have much fuel. Just enough to do little tiny maneuvers, which is all we should really need. But the closer we get to the moon, closer we get to the target, rather. I didn't make that the target. Yeah, the closer we get to the target, the lot more fuel it's going to take in order to actually burn to it. So that's why it's important to get these maneuvers done sooner rather than later. See that right there? It really looks like it's going into the orb. Because it's saying we're not going to get an exact reading. Like that. But if yeah, I'm not used to doing this anymore. Let's try this again. He's got a touch in. Nope. I think we're almost good anyway. That's a thing. I don't want to make it more difficult than it needs to be. Periaps 380. Why don't I just use the math? $370, $336, $210, $106, $66. Oh, there we go. It's going. That's got to do it. That's it. That's what we're doing. So we're going to warp to this maneuver. We only have our thrusters. Moon's going to get closer. Earth's going to get farther. Oops. There's the Earth. Kerbal. Face the maneuver. Joey asked me for a date. He wanted to take me out to skate. Whoa, what's going on? We don't have any fuel. Norman is my only fuel on this. What? Do, 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 do. This music is terrible. What is this? There we go. Mid-course correction towards the moon. A little bit of spare RCS fuel, monopropellant. Monopropellant, which was used for these smaller thrusters. Mono meaning it just was made of one particular chemical that just didn't really have a lot going on, just thrusted it out. Okay, this music's putting me to sleep. Oopsie. Okay. All right, let's warp to the moon. And yeah, warp there. We're getting closer. All right, now that we're that close, I might have been worrying for nothing. Let's get within the moon's influence. As soon as that we get past that green line, that's when we pretty much exit the Earth's orbital influence, and we actually get into the moon's orbital influence. Even though it's all the way back here, its orbit, its orbital, or its gravitational influence is going to be affecting our spacecraft. Because again, there's nothing out here. We're in space, and the only thing we got going for us is the energy that we've built up in our spacecraft. That's getting us. That's getting us motion. That's making us having motion through space. The only thing that would stop us from having the energy we've built up in the form of speed and velocity would be to hit something, either to hit something or to turn around in the exact same direction that we came from and then burn our rocket the other way, assuming we had the fuel. But spacecrafts generally aren't made that way unless they're specifically made to carry that much fuel, to do retro burn, and to get into an orbit around something. But they have all kind of tricks to do that to save as much fuel as possible. Man, 1762 just had a lot of just boring, sleepy music. Pat Boone, what is this stuff? Ray Charles. Okay. Yeah. All right, and by the way, when America did Ranger 4, they did lose control of this spacecraft, and they say this was a failed program. However, it was successful that it actually did crash into the moon, so it was the first time America had touched the moon, even though the Soviets had already done it. Whoa, guy. So yeah, let's get a little closer. Let's get into the influence. You can see the moon back there getting closer. Let's see. Now we can see where we're going, and we can see we are hitting the dark part of the moon. So good. We don't have to make any more weird course corrections. Matter of fact, I'm gonna. Right, so we were heading in that direction. However, now that the moon has gotten near us, our estimated trajectory, which was going off in this direction, as you can see, changed to this green line, because now that we're in the moon, giving us a more accurate reading. Now, if the moon wasn't a big rock, as you can see, if we wouldn't hit it, we would just, this is the estimated place where we would end up going because of our speed and trajectory, but we will end up hitting it on the dark side, which is where Ranger hit the moon also, Ranger 4 rather. So, and again, they had this detachable thing, which is weird, so I'm going to try to do that. So let's fast forward. we fall into the moon. Let's go. Oh no. Whoa. Let's slow it down a little bit. So we might turn backwards a bit. All right. And let's speed it up a little bit. Time speed. I don't know how much we're going to be able to save this. Whoa. Okay. There's the moon over the horizon. I mean, the Earth. I don't remember how far this thing was up. I remember reading exactly how far it was up. I can't remember what it was when this thing detached and launched. I'm going to put these... Now, see, this is working. Yeah, why didn't the other one work? So I'm going to detach it and activate our rocket at the same time. And this is a Spark rocket, if anybody was wondering. And that's hidden underneath the shroud. Here's the detachable. Yeah, but the seismometer that I have stuck in here somewhere. Yeah, I don't think any of this is going to survive. And again, I don't know how these guys thought that going to survive it at all. This mission was going to work as far as this weird detachable probe that they were trying to do. We better, we're getting close. We're 7 miles up. 6 miles up, we're falling real fast. Let's do it. Detach it. It's not detaching. Oh well. I wonder why it didn't detach. I thought I had fuel. Oh well, the real one failed anyway, so. crashed. Yep. Oh, that's what happened in real life. Let's go back to the space center. On that Ranger probe. And let's see. Please have. Yeah, obviously I'm not doing all 96. I did think about doing the Telstar, which was an AT&T satellite. So here's Ranger 4. I just did. Went to parking orbit, was put in the proper... Oh, yeah. It's put in the proper trajectory. Restart the booster. Failure of a timer caused loss of both internal ground controller vehicle. It had a lunar impact, so. And that happened in April. Alright, so moving on down to through the year of 1962. So we had another Mercury launch. There are two more Mercury launches. There are three Mercury launches total this year. And that's with the Mercury Atlas, which is the orbital launches. Here's Telstar. So for the sake of time, I am going to skip a Mercury launch. I might skip the Vostok launches too. There's two Vostoks, 3 and 4, which launched one day apart. And they sort of did a sort of a little... not quite a rendezvous with each other, because I don't think there's any way they could have seen each other. Supposedly, I think one of the cosmonauts claimed he saw the other guy from really far off looking like a small moon, but I don't know if I believe him. That's what he was seeing. We'll see. We'll see if I get too bored. All right, so we crashed that guy into the moon. So let me just stop yapping and let's get something else launching. The Telstar, I believe, should be pretty easy. What exactly was the Telstar satellite? Telstar 1. Communications launched by NASA on July 10th, 1962. AT&T. on a Thor Delta. Launched to a really crazy orbit. I don't have to really worry about it being in a fancy circular orbit. So this thing was launched 600 miles by 4,000 mile orbit. That's a really eccentric orbit. So let's see, it shouldn't be too hard to design right quick. I'm just going to use a probe core. So it's just a Thor Delta launch from Cape Canaveral. So I should have a Thor Delta already ready to go. Which I think I called these guys Thor. Or do I? If I don't, then I don't think I have a... Ooh. Because the Able rocket or the Agena, one of those turned into, so I have a Thor Able and a Thor Agena, but a Thor Delta? Oh no. Oh, that's a tiny. So that's very similar to the. It came from the earlier Able stages. Yeah, it was, so I could just make sure my Able is up to snuff and just change the name to Delta. Yeah, it's really bizarre, but that's what it is. The Thor Able, the Thor Delta. Actually, what did my Thor achieve? Yeah, because I don't want to take the Agena design, which is that. The Delta is going to be a lot smaller, but it was still a lot thinner. That's the thing. Now, I'm going to have to make a new one just for the Delta. Let's see. If I take that off. Let's see. Did I unlock anything new? That can sort of be a Delta rocket. That's what I use for the Agena. The Delta is going to be smaller than the Agena. Let's see. You know what? Delta versus Agena. I just want to look and see what their difference in size are. There we go. Agena. Yeah, there's all Agenas. Let's see, Thor Delta. Hold on. Basically the same exact. Oh. Here we go. Let's see it. What we got here? Thor Delta. I want to see an Agena next to a Delta. Delta. Looks like those are on some atlases. What we got there? Thor Delta. Oh, I'm not going to. Come on. Here's a Thor Delta. Yeah, I mean, they still look like the thin, weird one, so. Well, I know there's different Deltas, so I might as well just keep it on that thin design, even though it looks dumb. So, again, I'm going to have to make sure it's at least. Maybe put a better engine on it. Now it has a tiny spark. I don't know. Well, the point isn't the rocket anyway. So here, I'm getting stupid distracted. Point is the Telstar, just the fact that it was launched. So I shouldn't be taking so much stupid time on this. So I'm going to put a bunch of solar panels on this thing. Like is what the original one had. And yeah, just like the original. I'm going to put some batteries in it. Not that many. Oh, these might even be too big. Yeah, those are too big. I'm going to put these batteries in it. All right, let's just plug those in there. And then we're going to put some radio signal. That's it. Look for real ones, but it really wouldn't have antennas all over it or anything weird. No, it did not. It had one. That's some weird antenna on the top. So, Telstar One communication. I know it broadcasted TV signals across the world. July, shaped, weighed 170 pounds. Broadcasting relayed its first non-public television pictures. Almost 2 weeks later, it was used to publicly available a transatlantic television signal. Broadcast was shown in Europe by Eurovision. In North America by NBC, CBS, ABC. So this was a big deal when it happened. So let me not forget to put a radio signal thingy in here. Should I even use that kind? Yes. Actually. We'll do that, and we're gonna switch them. Oops. I don't want it to look too much like Sputnik. That's fine. All right, we're gonna reroute the entire thing to make sure that's the route. That way, we can get rid of. Oops. It's going to be as simple as possible. That. We're going to have to redo our fairing a bit. What's going on? All right, so it's going to detach. We got that. That's it. Telstar. It's going to be on a really high orbit, and then TV signals for Kerbals. All right, and this really tiny rocket, I'm afraid this is going to take too long. Who's the Spark? Is it the Spark that's what I'm using right now, isn't it? Sure is. We don't really have any other options. Except for this thud, which I can't change what it looks like. Yeah, I originally did want to redesign just for the Delta, but I'm going to have to do that later on. So yeah, I could use these for fuel tanks. Oh. Nope. Oh, that is a solid rocket booster. So the original one have that, because I might actually change that up. The original Thorogena. Yeah, it does. Oh, there's what I was looking for. If it has a solid booster, yeah. So we have a third stage at the top of this, which is a solid booster. So we have the big one at the bottom, then we have the liquid fuel here, and attached to the top of that is a solid, tinier solid booster rocket. So three stages. Okay, let's stop dilly-dallying and get this thing going. I'm going to do some auto-strutting. All of this. Alrighty. This music sucks. Nah, actually, I'm not into it. There we go. I'm sure if I was like at a school dance, I would love that song. Yeah. I don't have any sass mods. I'm gonna do all of this totally by hand. That's fine, including launching this at night. Whatever. All right, let's just get this done. All right, so we're gonna detach that. Then we got this staging, and then we got that staging. The shroud's gonna go up at some point. Alrighty. We don't have sets of very primitive rocket. I could probably change that up. Hopefully I can even control this at all. Let's see. Because I removed the one part of the probe core, which takes away the stability assist. I'm just doing this by hand. It kind of looks like the Atlas, but it's not. It's supposed to be the Thor rocket, which was a intermediate range ballistic missile. You know, it's similar size. Wow, this is chugging a lot of fuel. I mean, it's not a similar size, but like it's the same it is. But I have a different size engine, which changes the entire dynamic of a fast it burns and all that sort of thing. I forgot to look at what the inclination of this Telstar satellite was. No, I ain't too worried about it. Whatever inclination I can get this thing in orbit with is fine. But yeah, so this is supposed to be Telstar 1, and then I know there's a bunch of other Telstars later on going up into the. They probably have a Telstar 300 right now. Our speed's getting up there. Trying to get up. Not quite tipping it over yet. I'm not going to tip it over until we get to our second stage, until this rocket's out of fuel, this first Thor stage. Now, I know the Thor rocket is also used later with an Agena rocket as opposed to a Delta rocket, because again, the Agena is what's used for turning it on and off, and those were used for they used one for the when they do the Gemini program. They practice rendezvousing with the Agena rocket. All right, and we are getting up here very nicely. We're gonna that anymore. And this is really hard to control. Just to get an idea, so we're close to getting in orbit. So actually, you know what, I'm gonna wait until we get up to our apoapsis. So right now, as we've just launched from here, as we launched and that all that time, we're only this far from the planet, according to this. Right now we're about 96 miles up. In total, now our rocket engine has stopped, but in total, we're going to get, as according to this, 265 miles up. So we're just in a giant, like, rainbow arc. We're going to crash right back down. Unless we add more speed. So once I add more speed, it's going to make this arc get farther and farther out. And because the Earth is round, this arc is going to go over the curve. When it goes over the curve, it's going to be looping. So this is my headed direction, just to give an idea again on how orbits work. So I'm going to actually warp to up to our highest point, just about our highest point that we're going to get to. Whoop. So now we're just being tossed up at this highest arc. And we're going to start falling right back down if I don't make this rocket burn. Oh, as I'm doing this, you can see our orbit here is moving outward as we're increasing the speed that we're going faster and faster, which is making our arc take up more area. And at some point, it's going to get beyond the wideness, the circumference of the planet. Just remember, this is where we're heading. We're heading in this direction. But as we're adding speed, we're adding orbit. And now we're over, and now we have a periapsis. The periapsis is the lowest point on our orbit. Now it's at 40, increasing up. We need to make sure it gets... Actually, just to make sure I don't get too crazy. Actually, no, the original one's orbit was fine, so I'm going to keep... Well, I still have another whole stage, so I can still do this and sort of demonstrate. So I'm going to add this other maneuver. We're going to go to our new periapsis and warp there. Let's just get rid of that. So our new periapsis. Warp to next maneuver. Whoops. No. Stop. Stop that warp. Not sure what that was trying to do. Oh, that's the wrong direction. Whoops. We're heading down now. We need to increase our speed right now. Or we are dead. I really messed that up. I was in the wrong direction, or in the other direction. Right now we are falling. We're at 130 miles up, but we're at the other end of the orbit. So I need to increase this. All right, now we're good. I just increased it to where... You know I love you. Do anything for you. Just don't mistreat me. Because this had such a highly eccentric orbit, let me just burn the rest of this. Actually, I'm just going to keep it like that. This will be our Telstar. I'm not going to worry about that second stage. AT&T's first satellite. Yeah, I mean, it's just stable enough orbit, very eccentric orbit, just like the real one was. I could have did it in a more eccentric orbit, but I don't think it matters too much. Telstar. So yeah, this is where, you know, in addition to the military and the governments, you have private corporations, AT&T, getting involved in all this stuff so that it can relay its communication, its communications company. Alrighty. I'm going to return to the Space Center. I think I am going to do some Vostoks right quick. Yes, why not? So the Soviets, as I said, did do 2 Vostok missions. To where they launched, they had 2 in the same time, because a lot of the space race, it's funny, a lot of it was trying to just break records, like, oh, who's the first one that can send 2 spacecrafts in orbit at the same time. So So, you know, who's the first one that can rendezvous? Who can put the most people in space at the same time? Like this sort of thing. The Russians had also had already launched. I need to look it up now. They're the first one to break the record with sending three people in space at the same time. But all they did was basically have them just get they like removed the seats and they had them sitting there without space suits on. They just had like pressure suits on. So if anything went wrong, like they were like dead. Or no, I don't think they were in pressure. I think they were just like in normal clothes just to get them to fit in there. But it was basically just so they could fit into the spacecrafts just so they can say that they launched three people into space. No, I don't think that's happened yet. I don't remember what year that was. Although I don't know if I want to do this playing American music for these Vostoks. Although because this is like the John Glenn year, I don't know if I'm gonna. Actually, no, I'm not gonna do the Vostok shit. I want to do I want to do a Mercury Atlas from inside the cockpit. And I actually do want to do a successful landing of a Mercury Atlas. Oh, where are they? I call them Moho Atlas. So let's get that back up there. Let's get John Kerman back in there. We don't have a Wally. I think he's already. I'll use Wally later. Wally Schirra got kicked out of the space. He didn't get kicked out. He got himself in trouble during a Gemini program. He almost was like a moon guy. But that's a whole other story for later on. So yeah, I'm going to do another Mercury flight. So let's launch our Mercury flight. What am I thinking? Was there something else I needed? I wanted to change up. Too late now. Let's just do it. I can't tell them they were wrong, 'cause I'm afraid they'll leave me too. Now it's fun. I kind of don't want to launch at this weird time of day, but it's fine. Actually, no. I want to wait till it's. Okay, that's fine. Whatever. Almost didn't become nighttime. All right, so our first staging. I'm just going to check the staging, and then we got that, and we got that. Oh, let me demonstrate this thing. So if there was an emergency, let's see. This. Well, I wouldn't really be able to use it functionally. Technically, I should have this and this ready to detach at any time. Actually, it should be like this one. But maybe all of them. So all of a sudden, oh, the rocket's about to explode. We need to use, as long as this one's not detaching. Yes. And this was going to become our main stage. And then, boom! And it's supposed to carry us far away and up from the rocket. So that's pretty high. And now we detach that. And now the parachutes should save us. Oh no. Oh, that doesn't quite work. That parachute's got to come out way sooner than that. Well, good thing we didn't have any rocket emergencies. Where you had to. Oh no, I want to see if I can make that work properly. What is this? I want it 60s music. All right. All right, if I change the parachutes, yeah, I want that to, I want to make that functional. Pressure, altitude. Oh. What would that exactly be? Because we're never going to make it up there. It's lower than, so it doesn't matter. It's still going to be that low. Right angle. Let's try that again. Let's deploy it right away. All right, so an emergency, bam. This is going to go off. This is going to go off. This is going to go off. And your parachutes are going to go off at the same time. The parachute's got to be a little bit later, like a second later. So let's put the parachutes there. Boom. Oh, no. Get out of there. So now, here comes our guy. He's getting really dizzy. Parachutes come out. Drop that heat shield. There's our rocket still over there. Dude, what's up with those parachutes? Those parachutes don't, they just not slow down quick enough? Those parachutes are not doing it. That's unfortunate for our test kerbal there. I know I've landed these guys. It's just not, it's too much time. Or it's taking too much time to slow down. I think I still... All right, those parachutes have got to come out the same time. All right, let's try this again. Emergency happens. We got to blow that. We got to detach this. We got to attach this. And parachutes are all going to go at the same time. All right, so rocket starts blowing up, and then, oh, wait, hold up. Let's change that. I'm kind of confused on how I'm supposed to have the altitude, because we're already going to be low. I'm not sure if it's just not going to, well, now it deployed. All right. We're going to set them off at the same time. There's emergency happens, then... Now parachutes are already out. Catch all that stuff. Jettison the heat shield. Slowing down as much as it's going to get slowed. 20 is way too fast. Well, if you're gonna keep on messing, don't bring your business back ahead. I don't get that. Why don't you come home? Speedy Gonzales. We're gonna have to go back to the drawing board here. I don't think they added anything like extra that would make it super heavy. Like I said, I'm fairly certain I did. Is it the pressure? Let me take a look at these other parachutes that I have. Utility, we have. These are. These are bigger ones. I could just slap bigger ones on. No, I don't want to do that. How many parachutes did the original one have? Mercury parachutes. Full scale. Mercury program. Had three or two. What's this? U.S. capsules. An entire thing about their chutes. One main chute. Really? One main chute? Are you serious? A parachute, so the craft roll. A parachute. So I shouldn't even have it. Other one. Oh dear. Well, I know I've tested this and it was fine. Oh well. All right. You know what? Let's just change it up a little bit. And what do we got here? Nope. I'm just going to put this one. I'm going to offset it. Well, do I need to offset it? I don't think it matters too much if it's offset or not. Well, we've already crashed a couple times, so I don't care at this point. Let's offset it like that. And that looks kind of dumb. I'm going to have to just hide it. Just have it look like weird as it's coming out sideways. Out there. And there was a second one. Smaller one. Yeah, why not just add a second one? Just like there was a second drogue. We'll just hide that one too. We'll hide both of them. And let's see if that works. Well, yeah, so at this point, this is a little bit beyond the scope of the stream. It's been lasting for a few hours now. So now I'm just playing around. I launched a... I'm not sure if you're still around, Harry Hughes. I did launch a Telstar satellite with a really weird looking version of the Delta. and now I'm playing around with another Atlas. I mean, yeah, Atlas Mercury launch, since there were three that year. I do have a Scott Kerman, but I'm messing around with this launch escape system. The launch escape system, I'm finding out, doesn't actually save my Kerbals. So I'm going to play around with that just on stream, just for fun. Just to see how... This is rocket science. How real rocket science works. So I changed my parachutes. Put a giant chute and another drogue chute. And the altitude's supposed to mean when it gets lower than that, so I guess it really shouldn't matter if it's it's gonna come out anyway. I'd increase my spread angle, I guess. That doesn't matter either because it's only one of them. So again, if there's an emergency, these have got to go into the same thing. They're gonna detach. Oh no. All right, well, that didn't work. Let's revert to launch. Oh, boy. All right, let's try it again. Emergency happens. Let me make it a little bit brighter out. Let's get to the afternoon time. So if an emergency happens, this guy, our parachutes, not that one, but this one, not that one. All right, so if an emergency happened, boom, that's gonna launch up. Get rid of that, we got our chutes out. All right, now we're slow. Genesis and the heat shield. probably don't even need that smaller one. At least they work, so I wasn't sure if I could, like, clip them into something, like even those radial chutes that are supposed to go on the side. So I kind of tucked it in, but that works. So I could probably just get away with just that single chute. All right, so you can safely get out. Woohoo! All right, revert back to launch. Now that we have revised the parachutes. All right. Okay. Let's go. Oh yeah, I wanted to do it from inside. Well, it's going to be kind of boring at first because there's really nothing to do except for wait for it to get up high enough. And I can see our speed right here. 76, 70. We've got to wait for this to get to 500. Now remember, orbital speed's like 3,000. here's our navigational ball showing us where north and south is and east and west. So as long as we start tipping it over towards the right over there, it's pretty easy to just keep it in line and you don't really have to know what's going on outside around you. we're getting up there. So might as well just do it like this then. Okay, we're not tipping over quite a lot, so I am going to start tipping it a bit. So we at least have a little bit of, now there's going to be natural tipping over there because of the way the whole gravity of the Earth, the way the Earth is rotating in that particular direction, there's going to be a natural incline to go and or natural tendency to go in that direction. Now that we're up to about that, now I am going to tip it over a lot. I think we're up high enough to where we should be doing that. I'll also separate that second one. Right, I forgot to do that last time, which made us burn a lot of fuel. So that was that thing I just did was just separate those two engine carriages. Now we just separated that emergency thing. So we got to make it to orbit. At this point, look at that view. Look at that view. So we're got to burn our fuel out. Can I look and see? Can I move it like this? Yes. So at this point, yeah, as long as our fuel doesn't give out, now we'll probably be able to adjust our orbit once we get into orbit so that it's stable. Right now, where we get into orbit. Our apoapsis is 74 miles up. Our periapsis still negative 200. Now we're almost at negative 100. So once our periapsis gets above negative, we're at least up above the planet's surface on our periapsis. We're there. And our fuel is over. All right. So our periapsis is 64. So we're still dipping into the atmosphere a little bit, although we're done with this other rocket. Now I'm kind of paranoid. This is the wrong staging. That should be it. Do it. All right. So I think we've just separated from that second rocket. So we're inside of our little capsule here. So we got to activate our thrusters, our RCS. There we go. So we can turn around. Want to see the rocket we just separated from. Now, the original Mercury capsules, they didn't want them to, they weren't even going to have a window in it. The designers were like, whoa, what do you need a window for? You got everything you need. Oh, there's the rocket we just separated from. So we just separated from that guy, which is in orbit with us, apparently. Oh, no, no, we're not in proper orbit yet. So I am going to switch to the map. So we are at our periapsis, and we're going upward. So the thing to do is going to be, once we get here, we're going to do a maneuver burn, which is going to boost up our periapsis just a little bit. We don't want to do too much, because we need to make sure we can get back. And the only thing we're using to get back, again, are the retro rockets on the bottom of this thing. Those weird three solid rocket boosters. So I do want to warp there, but I need to plan a maneuver first. All right, why not? We'll just add a maneuver for a quick boost to increase that to about 89 is fine. So let us do that. All right, well, let me do that from this view to warp like that anyway. So we'll just do it here. We're going to warp to where the maneuver is. Switch back to that view. It's still going to take a minute because we're still too low for it to... when you're too low, the warp speed of increasing speed doesn't really go too fast. Otherwise, it would break the mechanics, kind of. Alright, now we're speeding up a bit. Oh, where are we? Come on, hurry it up. Aren't we up into... There we go. That'll make it a little faster. Okay. Once we get there, we're going to go back to our map. Actually, no, we shouldn't need to go back to our map. As soon as our warping stops, we're going to use the maneuver ball. Because we should see the blue. There we go. Point it. Make sure to point in that direction, and I'm going to hit the right switch for our future, for our periapsis. I can see it increasing. What I'm doing is puffing behind my my thrusters behind me to increase my speed a bit. There we go. Now we are in a proper orbit, 150 miles by 71 Kerbal miles. Orbit being 2,000 meters per second. I guess that's going to be Kerbal meters. It could be feet per second. Again, the game is not to scale, once again. There we go. So I've just orbited this thing from the cockpit of this Mercury capsule. Now I'm going to go outside the Mercury capsule just for some views. It's so slapped together, this retro rocket thing, because I realized that that what they did for this was so just because they're building it from scratch. So their retro rocket system, which was just these three solid rocket boost things just slapped together. But again, once you lit them, they're kind of like candles or dynamite, like you can't, well, not dynamite, but like a fuse. Like, you can't put it out once it's lit. Just gotta let it burn itself out. They weren't like thrusters. Now, the regular thrusters, like these things, so these are from monopropellant tanks. So these are from a different fuel tank than the other rockets. And that's the way for most spacecraft, as their main engines, which are using like liquid fuel. The liquid fuel is basically two separate fuels. That's why it's not called, you know, these are from monopropellant. The thrusters are from monopropellant. The liquid fuel main engines are usually from like, it's a diethyl, I'm drawing a blank all of a sudden on the rocket fuel names. But it's different types of rocket fuels mixed with liquid oxygen, because in space, like, you need oxygen is required for things to burn. So once you get into space, you need to add an oxygen mixture to your rocket fuel. And also, these fuels used in the early days were also like mixtures of kerosene. So a lot of very basic stuff. But this thing, the Mercury capsule's retro rocket, was solid fuel. When I go back to the timeline here, and I'm going to use CDs again. But when I see you passing by, my heart breaks down and cries a million tears. You broke my heart and set me free, but you forgot your memory. And it keeps right on a hurt since you're gone. It keeps right on. I'll be right back. Every minute of the day, every hour you're away, I feel so lonely, and I can't help it.
want your kiss, cause I just can't miss with a girl of charm like you. Come on and be my little good luck charm. Hey, you sweet delight. I want a good luck charm hanging on my arm. A to have, a to have, a to hope, a to hope, a to nigh. Don't want a silver dollar, rabbit's foot on a string. The happiness and your warm caress, no rabbit's foot can bring. You come on and be my little good luck charm. Hey, you sweet delight. I want a good luck charm hanging on my arm. A to have, a to have, a to hope, a to hope, a to mind. Oh yeah. Tonight, if I found a lucky penny, I'd toss it across the bay. Your love is worth all the gold on earth. No wonder that I say, come on and be my little good luck charm. Hey, you sweet delight. I want a good love charm hanging on my arm. I do have, I do have, I do hope, I do hope, I do mine.
Okay, I'm ready for a retro burn. I do want to have this happen underwater, so I'm about over here. We're going to do it. So let's warp there now. Other side of the planet, other side of the water. It's again our burn. It's got to be on the other side of the planet. Our maneuver has got to be there, because with orbital mechanics, the effect of your velocity change doesn't occur until you trip around the other side of your... Anyway, so I'm not necessarily doing this to conserve, because I don't think I need to. Hopefully I don't miscalculate that. We're about to find out. So I'm going to switch retrograde. All right, now, hopefully the same thing doesn't happen. All right, yeah, no. I'm going to switch my three rockets. We're activating these guys, and we're gonna decrease our... Let's do it. That's it. Our orbit is shrunk. Our periaps is now down. We're no longer a circle around the planet. We are an arc. That's heading straight into... Oh no, that's going into land. And that went way too far. Those rockets are way stronger than I thought. And we might still hit water. No, I don't think we're going to hit water. Let's hope those parachutes work. Well, that's really bad. I didn't really plan that too well. Go figure. These are all designed to land on water. Ugh. That's terrible. Nothing to be done now. I think that's all land. See, how high are we up now? We're definitely hitting land. That's what happened last time. All right, in any case, let's separate that thing. Don't need that anymore. All we need is our heat shield. We just separated our engine. Now we see the sunrise. Well, looks like we won't be landing in water, but our parachute should hold this time, though. Now, the original, these Mercury capsules, they were designed to be aerodynamic, so that the pilot could maneuver them in a certain way using their thrusters, just so where they're facing at just a certain different angle that they're going to come in and adjust their trajectory. And a lot of those maneuvers were just simply factored into the flight, although I don't know how practical they really ultimately became, especially when you're coming back from like the moon. Because when you're spinning around in the orbit of the planet, you're at one particular speed. But when you've added to your orbit to get you to the moon, remember, when you've added a lot of extra speed to get you out of the Earth's sphere of influence, out of Earth orbit, and to get you out of that, you're going to have to add more speed, add more rocket fuel, add more energy. So all of a sudden, you have all this more energy stored up. So then when you return back to the Earth, it's a higher speed from the moon, is my point, than if you're coming back from just simple orbit. This orbital speed is one thing. An orbit all the way out to the moon, like at that, you know, the higher the orbit, the more energy you're ultimately going to need to be consuming, especially to return back from it. And what we're seeing here is all of the energy bleeding off that we've built up from all the from achieving that orbital speed. And now, since we're slowing it down, we have to bleed off that energy, because everything is just energy. Everything is just motion. From burning the rocket, you're transforming the rocket energy chemical stuff to the speed of that physical object moving through space. And then once you're in space, you don't have wind. You don't need a lot more fuel. That's why you don't have to get... So right now, we're using the atmosphere to slow us down, one, equal to the speed of the energy force of what it took to get us up there. As we're returning down, you can see that's where the violence of what you're seeing. And also the rocket, the retro rockets that we burned. But again, burning a rocket in space, no atmosphere, it's a lot, makes a lot more change in your direction and stuff than it does when you're actually trying to get out of the atmosphere. All right. Yeah, the first, my first memory as a child of astronauts in any way at all was from I Dream of Jeannie, watching a rerun of that on my grandparents' huge television. Let me make sure that this parachute's like gonna parachute. Should. Yeah. I think we are in water. Nice. Is that water? I don't know if that's water or not. No, that's not water. Oh no. All right, there's one. Just gonna pretend that's water. Here's the second one. Yeah, the original one landed in on land. I don't think it would have gone well. But yeah, my original memory of astronauts was from my Dream of Jeannie cartoon, because, you know, as a kid, like, cartoons attracted my eye. So I remember the beginning of that show, because other than that, it was an adult show, so I didn't watch it too much. But just the first beginning of it, where it showed the cartoon astronaut guy coming down on the space capsule. And of course, I had no context for it. I was like a six-year-old seeing that. So I was just assumed that that's just what went on outside, was people were falling from the sky and in these weird space capsules. presumably found genies and lamps. Oh man, that thing is real slow. All right, so our dude would just be falling, waiting to land. I'm gonna speed up the Whoopsie.
Make me feel that you still love me. If it's just for one more day. Break it to me gently. Oh my tears.
Oh, we've landed. Yeah, so just ignoring that we didn't land in the ocean. I got to work on that particular aspect of accuracy, I guess. We're going to recover the vessel. Oh, yeah, at least I got it in orbit from the cockpit entirely, just from using the nav ball. Yeah, there is a mod that's just come out on this where it adds like forests and bushes and grass, and it looks like you could actually walk around like a role-playing game with your Kerbals in it. Like, I'm not gonna do all that. Not at this point. I thought it would be some wild stuff there. What more we got? Let's see here. Some of this music is getting me okay, we just need some kind of background stuff. Nothing necessarily specific. Alrighty. So what else did we want to get with? So the Americans also launched a similar probe to Venus. I decided I'm not going to do the Russian Mars mission because that failed altogether. Now I already did the Russian Venera mission, where the Russians launched a probe within range of Venus, very close to it. And this year, the Americans did it, in addition to the lunar impactor that they've already done too. Now, the Americans also did a a Venus probe, which got into the, which got close to Venus. So I'd like to get something close to Venus now. Now let's see, Ranger 3, so the American's other lunar probe. Well, that's done. I didn't do that one. That one just went past the moon. I decided to not really do that. I have to start choosing. Now that there's like 90 spacecraft launches a year, in the early 60s, I just pick and choose which ones I'm going to actually do. Do on online anyway. There's Telstar, Mariner. Is that the Venus one that actually did it? Yeah, so a Mariner, and Mariner's using an Atlas Agena. So pretty much same thing I used for the other one. So that's interesting. So the thing to get to Venus is the same one they used to get to the moon. So Atlas Agena. Now, that one didn't have an impactor. So I am going to have to redesign really quick the design first. So this is the lunar impactor. The only difference is going to be removing that top part. There isn't going to be this weird rocket thing on it. There's going to be like an antenna on it, and it's not going to separate because it's just going to be a straight up probe. I think I'm just going to put like an antenna. Well, let me take a look at what it looked like. Mariner 1. Well, is Mariner program? Was Mariner 1? I believe it was 1. Let me just look it up. Double check. I do have it all listed, but whoops. Oh, you know, did I forget to put that weird thing on the bottom of it? Where's that? Oh, I know that. Hold on. Ranger probe. Okay, so the Ranger probe. I totally forgot to put the, oh well, I'll put it on there now. So it has like an antenna with a bunch of cosmic ray detectors. You know, I remember taking it off there. Yeah, I because I had gotten this thing unlocked, but it was terrible. So I needed to use this. And why is it? Let me see something here. When this thing is extended, it's going to look like that. And I'm going to have to do it like this. So now, and now I'm thinking about just not doing the Mariner probe, just because I had the that out of whack. But hold up. I know it had this correct before. Because this is extended. This is retracted. So then it gets extended. Yeah, that should be fine. Just like that. All right, so I got that. And then I just need to put something real quick on the top part. Well, I'm going to put a battery. Nah, that's too big. What should I put there? Science. Magnetic boom. Before I do that, nope. I'm going to put that just to give it some shape. There's a lot of this stuff I just can't mess with. Not a lot of stuff it can be used to make it look like the original one. So I have the basic probe. We got that. Um, Oh, I have these threats. That's right. I also, yeah, so I really left that undone. So I got to put some mono propellant fuel in it, which I'm going to put two of these guys. Do that. We're just going to insert them right into there, like so. Now we got, because I think that was an issue on the moon one, on the Ranger probe. And again, this, the Mariner probes are highly based on this one. And I do want to put a separate radio on this, which I'm going to tuck in as well. I'm not worried about that being symmetrical at all. And then I finally want to put, for science, I want to put a magnetic boom on the end there. I'm going to put that down in like that. Because, again, it's a Mariner. Ranger. That's the one I had already crashed to the moon. Mariner probe is this. So that's good enough. That's fine. This is fine. I'm going to start getting... Actually, you know what? I do want to change it. I just noticed I want to change it. I want to put, instead of this... Also, because I need to save weight, and yeah, never mind. Yeah, we're gonna keep it like that. I'm getting too. All right, so I'm going to chain a Mariner. So what's a Mariner? Pirate. A pirate one. All right, so we're checking our fuel. I kind of think, so this has got as much fuel as possible. The rockets I have turned up, except for that not middle one. So I can kind of get into a better orbit. I'm going to add fuel to that a little bit. Oh dear, what's that sticking out? Oh, that's nothing. All right, so we got Pirate One. I'm saving Pirate One. It's a Atlas Agena launching to Venus, or in this game, it's called Eve. And we've already, humans have already done this. The Soviets have already done this in their Venera probe from previous years. Now, nobody's actually launched anything into Venus yet. All right, so let's get this guy into a, let's check our staging going on. These two, oops. I just do. Not sure what I just hit, but I think we're good on this anyway. Let's do it. Adding that fuel to the Agena, just adding that little tiny bit of fuel, I think really made this a lot slower. Alrighty. So, yeah, just like the... Oh, you know, I didn't even check our Venus transit window. I think we're close, because it's not too far in the game from when I did the Russian Venus one. So, I should be able to compensate enough to just get a nice view of Venus, a flyby. Even though the Americans did it, so the Americans' Mariner probe also failed like they know they flew by it, but they didn't actually get any readings. Like they know it, they know they flew by it mathematically. But it was still kind of a milestone that they did it anyway, that they actually successfully mathematically did it. Because that's the thing, like, but once you know the direction that something is heading in, as long as you know that some random thing isn't going to stop it from heading in that direction because it's in space, so it's not likely at all that something is going to stop something from moving in the direction that it's heading. So as long as you know the direction something's heading, like you can track it, you can track everything that's in space. It's wobbling. Yeah, so unfortunately this thing, because that's a bit, you know, that was the thing back then. They were just, they knew mathematically where they had to point these things and launch the rockets. Because once you're in space, the math is just the math. It's the direction something's headed. You can make it go a certain speed in a certain direction, then that's what you're doing. That's what you're tracking. It's not going to change. So, like, for example, just because this probe, we know this probe absolutely failed. The machines failed. They know which direction it was headed in. Like, it didn't explode. They know it didn't. Like, I mean, so you could argue, well, sure, on a philosophical level, there's a chance that it exploded for some reason, but they don't. It's unlikely it exploded rather than the equipment failed, because there were a bunch of failures on these particular types of rockets. 43,000. Am I? Hold up. I'm still really low. My periapsis is really bad. Like, my speed's increasing though, so. And I'm dropping. This isn't good. I've been talking and not paying attention. And, I think this is gonna crash into the water. Yeah, we're not even out of the atmosphere yet, and we got up a lot of speed, but we're not high enough at all. And this bottom part's about to run out of fuel. This might. Now, the first couple Mariners failed too, so I'm not, you know, not necessarily ahistorical to be messing this up. But yeah, I can tell because I can see we're just, well, now we're not dropping anymore. Actually, our apoapsis is rising, so we've kind of saved it a little bit just with the extra fuel. All right, hold up. We need to save fuel. So I just boosted our, we're going, because we were going so fast, we were able to bounce off the atmosphere, basically. Not quite bounce off it, because we were just going that fast. We were able to pick up enough speed to where, even though we dipped into the atmosphere, we're right here. We're going up, really high up. And it's so fast in this direction that we're going 300 miles up. I'm making it. Once we get up to 300 miles, we are going to boost. We're gonna add velocity when we get up here, and it's gonna make our other side of our circle bulge out, and make our circle more circular, into an orbit. That is, say. So yeah, let's warp there. Oh. We're going to want to get rid of the shroud so we can get our solar panel. So that's a little... Oops. Oh no. Well, that... Let's try again. Right. We're facing in our direction. Let me do it real slow. You can see where our orbit now. Here's where we are. Facing this direction, the other side of our orbit is bulging out. We're going to keep doing it until right over here, we're 300 miles up. The other side, as we, this is our projected where we're headed. Whenever we're in space, you're always headed where you're headed. Now we're 100 miles over there. It's just because we're orbiting around this thing. One side of the orbit of the circle is 300. The other side right now is 120. 130. I'm going to pick up the speed. Okay, we're a little bit more. 16 by 8. I think that's close enough in a circle. Alright. Now that we're in we're in a nice stable orbit around the planet, we have a lot more fuel we can use. That we're going to use that to kick us out of entire Earth orbit. And here's our other planets in the solar system. The purple one is our Venus, which is Eve. So we're in our orbit here. I am going to, it doesn't matter where I do it, because we're in a circle now. So I'm going to add a maneuver just where I know I'm going to be using a lot of fuel. So bam. And as you can see, this is just projected however much fuel I end up burning for 13 seconds. If I burn it for 15 seconds, is how far it takes me. That's as far as the moon. If I burn this rocket for 20 seconds, for 17 seconds, you can see that I can just keep burning fuel and it's going to take me out eventually of Earth's. Because our orbit's going to be, all orbits are round, but our orbit's basically going to cease to become a circle. It's just going to be going out of Earth's influence. So that's what's happening now with that burn. So now it's to get me out of the influence of Earth and hitting Venus. Now, Venus's influence. I mean, I might be in a bad way to do this. As far as being able to, like, there's what's called a transfer window. This planet over here got to be in the right spot versus this planet, our Earth planet. I think it's kind of close, though. Let's see. I'm going to add a maneuver. And like, our maneuver window shouldn't be this. There we go. Look at that. Look at that over there. It's close to where... We're hitting close to Venus. That's not that close. 146,000 miles away. There we go. Look at that. 80,000. That's 80 million. So we can probably do a little better than that. But even with this, that's 23-second burn. We are going to get within the sphere of influence of Venus on a flyby. I'm going to try to get us closer, though. Right now, where that would be 80. I'm going to just adjust these a bit. I wonder if I should just get the Mech Jeb mod that just lets me do this automatically. All right, we're gonna do that. Nope. All right, that doesn't do anything. Let's change that back. I'm just going to switch to these back and forth. Right, that doesn't do anything. I need to switch this. Or revert it, rather. 18. 37. I need to switch it back. Well, let me do our 24 minute burn. That's close enough. Well, is it close enough? I don't know. I kind of want to try to make it closer. We have enough fuel. So, I mean, this is it. This is part of the game, is trying to calculate this stuff. Now, you can download a mod that will do it all for you. I might end up doing that, like, eventually. Just because, I mean, eventually once the modern era of space travel is just kind of like demands it. But it's amazing to think that at this point we had people who were sitting around with slide rulers on calculators and stuff, trying to figure out the correct speed, the correct heading, in order to send these things off, as well as anticipating the technology at the time, what can be used. So this is taking us close. I'm just trying to get, I'm trying to kind of pinpoint it a little more exact. It's kind of difficult because I think it's about as close I'm going to be able to do it. 72 or 70. I'm really trying to pinpoint it as exact as possible. Get as close as possible. But if I go a little farther, 71. That took us out. 74. 70. 64. Here's 64. This means 64, like, million. Like, miles away. Which is way too far. I think. I can just make course correction later. Matter of fact, I'm just going to do that. So we're going to fast forward to our burn just to get this going, because this is getting a little too somber. So let's fast forward to that, because we're still in our parking orbit. Switch back to there. We got a 26 second burn. All right. That's how close we're getting to Venus right now. I'm going to fast forward it until we're outside of the influence. Oh, how far away the planet's getting. That's how far away we're going. Oops. All right, so Earth's way back there now. We're really far off. So let's fast forward a little bit more. All right, so now we're still getting close enough to Venus. 2 second burn, we're getting within 71. We can get, so yeah, I think we can get closer than that. 6. It's around the same level as just looking at that. Looks like we could adjust it upward. It's 33. So let's see. 32. 9. All right, that's really, we're doing it. 2. Staying at 2. We need to change something here. It's back to 4. 2. 3. 2. 5. And we're adjusting it. Now we're at 11 there. Alright, so we're getting closer. We're back to 4. That's 24 days from now. We have to do this course correction. I wonder if I adjust that. I just messed that up. All right, let's do this again. 80 something. I'm going to do this. I'm going to get a flyby of Venus. I'm very determined. 66. Wait, let's put that back. It shows us here where the point of... Alright, that is... Oh, come on. There we go, 56. 51. 39. That's meters. So that's kilometers. 900 kilometers, 38,000. So this is close to 38,000 kilometers. So definitely that'll be miles, or 38,000 miles as far as game miles go. 36. Holding at 36. 24. 20. 18. I think we're at 17. 15. 4,000. So I think that's pretty good. Let's do it. So the mid-course correction, which in real life was done by the actual spacecraft with its RCS thrusters, although it probably took a lot longer than it's going to take for me to do this. Although we're really getting really far out of range. And we are out of range. Or is that our... I'm going to have to change the settings for the network. Because I don't think the stock... Yeah, it looks like the stock... where's that? Stock radio antennas don't go that far. I don't remember having to do that for the other one. Except for this is the high gain antenna. I didn't think it was that was. So it must be that, in addition, the high gain antenna isn't enough. I'm gonna have to change. What is that gonna be in settings? I think I can just change it from here. I hate doing this. It sucks. So, can I do it from here? Basically, you have to change the. Like each bit, you basically make it not use the network. I don't know if you can do that from here. So let's see. I can basically. What can I do with this? Salvage this. Well, it's going to stay there. I wonder if I can boost my trend. I'm going to have to do something with it because I want that flyby. Before I end this stream, I want to do that flyby. So that thing's still there. I want to see if I can either upgrade my tracking center to go farther. That's not what I wanted to do. Or I'm just going to have to turn off the deep space network settings for now. I want to get the flyby at least. Just because I want to. So let's see. This max power along with the 50 G's. Not sure what that means necessarily. Object tracking. Like if that'll make it. You know what? I'm going to do it. Me from the curb from the KS government. There we go. Still not enough, eh? there. I don't know if that's going to be enough. There's our pirate one. Let's go back to that and see if we can actually control it, if we can get control of it again, or get make contact with it. We've upgraded our communication systems a bit. With some help from the KS government. Oh, yes, we have very small signal strength. We're 1 minute and something behind schedule. I wonder if we can still... What's that doing for us? Oh, still no flyby. All right, come on. And add another maneuver. Let's maybe do some more. Yes. Okay. Yeah. 32,000 kilometers. 44,000 kilometers. 38. All right, I know we're not far off. 18,000 miles. Because that's kilometers, but whatever, or just meters. 16,000. 18,000. We gotta shift that a little bit more. 16 again. 11. 10. 10. Down to 9. 5. 5.3, 5.3, 4.3, back up to 5. All right, so we're at a... Right, so here's our 4.4. Something. One. All right, we're down into the hundreds. 100. Oh, we're really close there. 100 kilometers. We're doing it. All right, so again, we're going to try this again. We're going to warp to, we should still have a signal now. We've upgraded our signal. We have 10% strength, which means we're not, this is going to be our last maneuver we can do with this big rocket. So I thought Doo-Wop was like... May they still be the same. All right. I can't have that anymore.
Hey,
Car maneuver. It's a very... I probably am not better off using a stronger rocket versus my smaller thrusters. This is a very pinpoint maneuver. It's got to be done. I'm trying to get within, like... that's even... ugh. 370. That's good enough. 370 kilometers away. Alright. So, Brayden. There we go. Our Mariner probe. Heading to Venus. Did I even add? I knew I had it, some more science into this thing. I have the boom, a magnet. Yeah. There's the monopropellant fuel. Maybe not. It was just a matter of just the camera, the antenna. Well, that's why they have different Mariner programs. And the camera flyby thing was really cool. All right, so we're going to fast forward it and get there. Oh, there's Venera. Well, there, so it's kind of like the American version of Venera. That's weird. I don't know if that's, maybe is that even going to be accurate? Find out. All right, we're warping super fast. There's how far away we are from Venus now. I'm not sure. It says Eve periapsis, is it? Yeah. Control locked. Yeah, we're totally out of range of anything, any kind of controlling. Like sending a signal would be impossible. Although I guess receiving a signal is fine or something like that. Might as well do it. Let's warp there. Can we see the planet yet? Somewhere. Oh, there's a planet. Right over there. Let's warp a little closer. All right, we're heading straight 4,000 meters. Or no, that would be 4,000 kilometers away, which is cool. So we're not going to blow up. Although that would still be a milestone to actually hit the planet, which I think I accidentally did when I did the Venera probe. I did one of them. All right, so we got our flyby. I'm going to fast forward it to where we get closer to this guy. There's a planet really far away. Venus is around the same size as Earth. Just for a little Venus trivia, whoever happens to be watching this at this point. after over 3 hours. And let's get a little closer. So there's our planet. That's going to get closer and closer on the horizon. still going to have to get closer. Yeah, so Venus, about the same size as the planet Earth. Because of its size, it has an atmosphere. It can hold an atmosphere on it. And it does. And so we have like the effect of the heat being locked into it. Venus's surface is super hot. And it's also got a lot of pressure because the clouds and that sort of thing, like the air pressure, the motion, it's very turbulent because of the, I guess well, and that's what all the science is all about. All the science. Let's get closer. So yeah, the only mod that I am using in this is the Eve mod, which gives the planet's atmospheres. Which I think is a little bit cooler than just seeing just the, I mean, I don't know. I kind of wanted to keep it raw with like just the main non-modded game, but I think having atmosphere clouds is cloud effects is just too much, too cool to not do. Yeah, I did put more antennas on this thing. And so this thing has a high gain antenna. And it does have combinable. So the high gain, it's interesting. So I haven't messed with the science of this in a while. Plus, I had modded game before. Combinable. So that means I could put a whole bunch of high gain antennas together. So presumably put like a bunch together, like is what I'm going to need to do. Or a bunch of regular antennas. Or a whole bunch of any kind of antennas, I guess, which would increase the range. So that's where experimenting. That's why this game is cool, because then you can actually really experiment. You're like, oh, how many antennas is it going to take? I mean, I'm sure I could just look it up. In order to be able to reach back to home with signals. Because obviously, once we start building probes or like rovers and that sort of thing, you're going to need to be able to do that. But again, in real life, the spacecraft, this one also we lost contact with. But we just did the flyby. So yeah, I don't think I am going to do the Vostok mission. Yeah, they simply, they did maneuvers together, rendezvous. But since I've already been going for 3 hours here, I'm going to cut this after I do this flyby. After this flyby completes. Oh, I could just leave it going for another 40 minutes until it, or however long that would actually take. A couple days if I just let it play out. A couple months. Excuse me. I'll be right back.
So lonely they could die.
All right. I believe this is as close as we're going to get. Not much more. Well, it's a darn good life, and it's kind of funny how the Lord made the bee and the bee. Oh, nice. It's like bubblegum or cotton candy. So yeah, we're still pretty far away from it. Yeah, it's not a couple years off till the Soviets actually get a lander on that thing in Venus. But the pressure on the surface of Venus is similar to like the pressure under the ocean of Earth. It's so intense. It's also like the atmosphere itself is very like corrosive, supposedly. Although the way the pressure is the pressure towards the surface is so dense that they say like they could build like cloud cities over top of that dense air very easily, to where you would just keep something like raised, and then the air pressure at that super high altitude on Venus is very similar to what it is on Earth. So, I mean, still need breathable air though. Also, if you were standing on Venus, like the surface is, because it's so dense, it's so windy. But the wind at the top is basically, or the air layers at the top are spinning around the planet at a different rate than the air at the bottom. So you could basically look up, and it would look like you could see the clouds moving at like super rates. It's also weird that Venus is spinning at a different rotation than the other planets. And I've heard of all kind of weird theories about that, which I don't think I'm going to get into at this point. But yeah, I think I'm going to end it in a minute. I'm going to get another coffee real quick though. See how many more songs I can. Surprise, the stream isn't shut down yet. So I know these songs are all copyrighted. All right, friends. I do appreciate anybody's participation. And hopefully you got some enjoyment out of this, or some education or entertainment, whatever floats your boat. I certainly have fun with some of these things. But where about, I would love to go on for hours and hours and hours more playing this. I don't think I can take it. So we will start again for next year, 1963, where obviously we're going to get some more manned launches. Gemini program isn't quite ready yet. Yeah, it's going to be pretty standard until we get to the moon launches, but pretty soon we're going to get, obviously we're going to get more Mars launches, but a lot of these are just going to be refinements of the previous ones when it comes to the Gemini program, the Mercury program, and especially with the Vostok program. The Russian ones are just continuously changing theirs up. So it'll be interesting also seeing the way that each nation separately approaches the space race in general, as far as their approach towards sending probes to the moon, such as, you know, the Soviets also attempted a lot of automated stuff, as well as return probes that landed and then scooped up dirt and then actually successfully brought it back to Earth. And there's even a chance that I would try to build like the actual Soviet version, although on the stock, probably not. But anyway, we're getting into 3.5 hours. We're now past 3.5 hours. I wanted to make it solid through. Anyway, thank you very much, friends. And coming at you from planet Eve in the Kerbin solar system. I bid you all a very good evening. Until next time, Space Cadets.